Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tesla, Wizard at War, The Genius, The Particle Beam Weapon, and The Pursuit of Power, by Marc J. Seifer. Narrated by Simon Vance. In knowing George Lucas all these years, I've experienced the Force. He's a pathfinder, a pioneer, like Edison, Bell, and Tesla, and Jobs, in the way that everything they touched changed a paradigm. Steven Spielberg, at the Kennedy Center, December 30th, 2015. For my mother, Thelma Imber Seifer, and father, Stanley Seifer. Preamble. In 1896, Nikola Tesla receives Swami Vivekananda in his laboratory. And what is the laboratory for Tesla? It is not just a location, some place where he sees some experiments to sell them, as many scientists do nowadays. No, it is his temple, where he explores, where he is in connection with the universe and higher beings, and where he works. When Vivekananda came, he was completely shocked because Tesla first attached himself to various currents and glowed in the dark, and these were emanations of Indian gods. Indra is the one in Indian mythology who throws lightning, and the other divinities also appear for certain visions that are very similar to the electrical sights Vivekananda saw in Tesla's laboratory. These were strong electrical discharges to which Tesla was attached. He would calculate the capacitance of his body. I mean the electricity, so that it doesn't damage him and he can glow for half an hour without a problem. Vivekananda was completely puzzled. Tesla is the only Western man who was granted the status of a saint in India, for example. If you go to Kolkata, you will find Vivekananda's centre there, and if you go inside, you will not see either Ramakrishna's or Vivekananda's portrait. You will find Tesla's portrait in the first place, because Vivekananda says in his letters, "I met a man who is completely different from all the other men here in the West. His origin is above the origin of some Indian divinities." He discusses Shiva, Vishnu, and Krishna. "In Tesla's electrical discharges," Vivekananda says, "I even felt the presence of Brahma himself." Velimir Abramovich. Chapter 1. Introduction. Wizard at War. On Saturday, January 9, 1943, I was on the staff of the Office of the Alien Property as a custodian, senior examiner attorney, stationed in New York office, 120 Broadway. At about noon, we were alerted by telephone from the Washington office that a Nikola Tesla had just died and that he was reputed to have invented and in possession of a death ray, a significant military device capable of destroying incoming warplanes, presumably Japanese on the West Coast, by projecting a beam into the skies, creating a field of energy which would cause the planes to disintegrate. Moreover, it was suspected that Germans, enemy agents, were in hot pursuit to locate the device or the plans for its production. I was instructed to proceed to the hotel where Tesla had died and to impound all of his belongings. Irving Giroux, personal letter to Marc J. Seifer, July 5, 1993. Irving Giroux, who was a young attorney during the height of World War II, recalled that Tesla's nephew, Sava Kosanovich, had already been to Tesla's room and had removed at least one item, presumably a photograph. Giroux was told that Kosanovich was an ambassador from Romania, although he was actually the ambassador from Yugoslavia, but at this point he had no idea who Tesla was. Here it was, 50 years later, and Giroux recounted that his first impression of the inventor was that the deceased man, whose body had been found by a maid, naked except for a pair of leg warmers, was a deadbeat, who didn't pay his rent to other hotels, and that his trunks were filled with bird seed and newspapers. Giroux had received working orders derived from a bevy of top officials who were concerned that the Germans were trying to obtain Tesla's death ray, a number of whom were in direct contact with Franklin Delano Roosevelt, President of the United States. The initial order to impound Tesla's effects stemmed from Vannevar Bush, founder of the Raytheon Corporation, former dean of the engineering department of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, and then head of the Office of Scientific Research and Development, OSRD, who was also at that time in charge of the top-secret Manhattan Project. Bush sent his directive to LMC Smith, heir to the Smith Corona fortune and head of the Special War Policies Unit in Washington, D.C., who alerted J. Edgar Hoover of the FBI that the Office of Alien Property, OAP, had jurisdiction and that they would take charge. Walter Gorsuch, head of the OAP in New York, was given the directive. He gave Giraud the order to seize Tesla's estate, and the young attorney complied. Giraud stated that there was the fear that the Russians had offered Tesla $50 million for his death ray, and because of that he was accompanied by military advisers from Army Intelligence, the Office of Naval Intelligence, and the Office of Strategic Service, OSS, to the Hotel New Yorker, where Tesla had lived, to impound his effects. In short order, Giraud verified that indeed Tesla was a deadbeat who still owed rent to the Waldorf Astoria, the Hotel Pennsylvania, the Hotel St. Regis, and the Hotel Governor Clinton, where he had in some or all of these places various trunks being held as collateral against his various debts. One can only imagine Giraud's state of mind when he was told by the people at the Westinghouse Corporation that there would be no Westinghouse if it weren't for Tesla. I first became aware of Nikola Tesla in 1976, which was 33 years after his death. Clearly, Tesla's name had disappeared from the mainstream, his legacy kept alive in the underground by John O'Neill's 1944 watershed biography Prodigal Genius, which was being distributed by a UFO organization. What this meant was that very few individuals in the country knew who Tesla was, and that many of those who did know Tesla's name connected him to occult circles and extraterrestrial beings. The 1970s were an exciting time for me. In the early part of the decade, I left a job in New York City to begin graduate work at the University of Chicago. I had no idea that the university was such a prestigious place. Already, by that time, there were something like 50 Nobel Prize winners coming from that school. To add to the university's cachet, it sat at the site of the 1893 Chicago World's Fair, with the science building from the fair just several hundred feet from my dorm. When I had a class in a building along the Midway, that referred to the Midway from the fair, where the great Ferris wheel had been situated. I had never heard of Tesla at that time, circa 1972 to 1973, so I had no way of knowing that this location would later loom so large in my research and my psyche, because the fair marked the introduction of Nikola Tesla onto the world stage as the inventor of our AC power system, the global electrical network often called the grid, which is essentially unchanged today, well over 100 years later. I decided to make the study of the unconscious the subject of my master's thesis, and this took me beyond the theories of Freud and Jung to the realm of parapsychology and the topic of telepathy. To my astonishment, I found that J.B. Rhine had conducted many successful telepathy experiments at Duke University, stemming back to the 1930s. I also became aware that in Great Britain, such famous scientists and electrical engineers as Sir William Crookes, Lord Rayleigh, and Sir Oliver Lodge, who I would later find out were all close associates of Tesla, as members of the British Society of Psychical Research, also studied telepathy, and were thus able to verify this ability in human beings. This work enabled me to design a course on parapsychology, which I taught at the night schools of the University of Rhode Island and Providence College. And that endeavour led me to such books as Psychic Discoveries Behind the Iron Curtain by Sheila Ostrander and Lynn Schroeder and Andrea Puharich's masterwork Beyond Telepathy, wherein Puharich discussed his experiments with various psychics, in particular Eileen Garrett, who was able to obtain telepathic information when seated inside a Faraday cage, which was a mesh enclosure that blocked out electromagnetic waves. Talking with the Planets. In 1901, Tesla wrote an article in Collier's magazine with that fantastic title. I can never forget the first sensations I experienced when it dawned upon me that I had observed something possibly of incalculable consequences to mankind. I felt as though I were present at the birth of a new knowledge or the revelation of a great truth. Even now, at times, I can vividly recall the incident and see my apparatus as though it were actually before me. My first observations positively terrified me, as there was present in them something mysterious, not to say supernatural. It was shortly after a massive thunderstorm in the summer of 1899, and I was alone in my Colorado Springs laboratory at night. This article was written in conjunction with a letter to the Red Cross, which was penned during Christmas of 1900, shortly after Tesla's return to New York from his incredible experiments in wireless communication out in Colorado Springs. I have observed electrical actions which have appeared inexplicable. Faint and uncertain though they were, they have given me a deep conviction and foreknowledge that ere long all human beings on this globe, as one, will turn their eyes to the firmament above with feelings of love and reverence, thrilled by the glad news. Brethren, we have a message from another world, unknown and remote. It reads, 1, 2, 3. Nikola Tesla. Caught up in extraterrestrial fever, the March 11, 1906 issue of the New York American newspaper began with an opening headline by Nikola Tesla, which read, "Only a matter of patience now." Covering a full two-page spread, the article was adorned with several creative drawings of what extraterrestrials might actually look like, some resembling animals, bug-eyed with antennae, and the so-called canals of Mars. Also seen on this fantastic spread was Tesla's iconic Wardenclyffe Tower, which the artist placed at Niagara Falls, and a gigantic fairy rising up from the tower to whisper to a man on the red planet. But the piece was headlined by Tesla's arch competitor, which read as follows. "Marconi says, 10 years from now, we may be talking with inhabitants of the planet Mars." Not to be outdone by the Italian upstart, 5 years after announcing to the world that he may have received signals from Mars, the Serbian wonder-maker got a bit bolder. New York American, 1906. "With 1 billion horsepower drawn from Niagara," Tesla said, he was not only going to send a signal back to Mars, but 100 times further, to Neptune. Whether we can get an answer or not depends on who is there. More than likely the first answer from my neighbour will be, "Well, well, at last. We have been calling you the last 10,000 years. Nikola Tesla. In 1975, I met Howard Smuckler, who was teaching a course on UFOs at the University of Rhode Island and also the New School in New York. And so, together, we created an academic journal focused on the topic of parapsychology. Soon after, he became editor of 2 national magazines, Ancient Astronauts and ESP Magazine, and I became one of the main writers. This work led to my discovery of an odd book on avatars that suggested that a man with a strange name of Nikola Tesla had arrived to the Earth from the planet Venus to give us such inventions as the induction motor, the hydroelectric power system, fluorescent and neon lights, remote control capabilities, and robotics. I thought the story absurd. However, since I was in the New York Public Library, I looked up the name and found, to my astonishment, an article by Tesla on high-frequency phenomena. When I returned to Rhode Island, Howard handed me 2 books, Prodigal Genius, an exceptional biography of Tesla by science writer John O'Neill, and a nutty book called Nikola Tesla and the Venusian Spaceship by Arthur Matthews, which contained Tesla's entire autobiography, unavailable in any other form at that time, and a ridiculous story that Tesla was still alive at the age of 114, flying around in a UFO, occasionally landing in Matthew's backyard, which was someplace north of Quebec. By that time, I had met Andrea Puharich at a conference on consciousness held at Harvard University, and thus became aware that Andrea had visited Arthur Matthews to find out more about his so-called Teslascope, which supposedly interacted with extraterrestrials. The rumour was that Puharich was funded for his ESP work by the CIA. So I suggested we set up an interview, and Howard agreed. Andrea's living near Sing Sing Prison in Ossining, New York, added to the allure of the meeting. Andrea cordially invited us into his living room. Among other things, Andrea stated that everything in his room had levitated, except for the piano. I asked him what it was like working for the CIA, and he said he felt like he was sitting in the dentist's chair with his hands holding the dentist's testicles. With regards to Tesla, he said he had met with Matthews at his home north of Quebec and accepted at face value the possibility that the Tesla scope was real, but was disappointed that the odd fellow was unable to demonstrate the equipment. Fearful of secret agents, Matthews told Andrea that he had hidden the various components in different places. We also discussed Puharich's work with the Israeli super-psychic Yuri Geller, who by this time we had also met, and we tried to find out more information as to why their relationship fell apart. While we were walking the property, Andrea showed me his watch, which he said was controlled by extraterrestrials. When they wanted to contact him, the watch moved. Clearly, spending time with Andrea Puharich strained one's credulity. The field of parapsychology was a minefield, and it became near impossible to determine where reality ended and fantasy began. However, Andrea also had written a well-constructed book on technical aspects of Tesla's wireless tower at Wardenclyffe, and he also had a great deal of information about one of Tesla's engineering associates whom Puharich had worked with. Many of Puharich's telepathy experiments were conducted with John Hayes Hammond, Jr., at the Hammond Castle located in Gloucester, Massachusetts. Jack, as he was also called, a wunderkind inventor himself with over 700 patents, as I would later find out, was a pre-World War I business partner of Tesla. Hammond's father, who had made his fortune in gold and diamond mines from South Africa, had helped fund Tesla's remote-controlled robot, according to O'Neill, giving Tesla $40,000 towards the creation of this invention. So Hammond had known Tesla ever since he was a boy. Having studied this device, which Tesla called the teleautomaton, Hammond duplicated and improved on what became known as the radio guidance system, which the younger inventor eventually sold to the military. The basis of this invention, which Hammond hailed as Tesla's prophetic genius patent, also lay at the heart of protected privacy, Wi-Fi, and drone warfare devices. Tesla's ability to combine frequencies and alter their sequencing as far back as 1898 enabled him to create a virtually unlimited number of separate wireless channels, and that set the stage for what became cell phone technology, radio guidance systems, encryption, and even remote-controlled robotics. Tesla's particle beam weapon. Western Union Telegram, March 1, 1941, to Savo Kasanovic. One will need 9 stations for Serbia, 3 for Croatia, and 2 for Slovenia, and everyone needs 200 kV which can defend our dear homeland against any type of attack. Nikola Tesla. In 1940, at the very outset of what came to be called the Second World War, the actor and later-day President Ronald Reagan starred in a movie that capitalized on the public's great interest in secret weapons, and in particular Tesla's so-called death ray. Join Ronald Reagan battling 20,000 unseen enemies in Murder in the Air, 1940, a major motion picture. This is the most terrifying weapon ever invented, the Death Ray Projector. Well, it seems the spy ring has designed one of the greatest war weapons ever invented, Ronald Reagan, as Secret Agent Brass Bancroft warns, which, by the way, is the exclusive property of Uncle Sam. This new weapon not only makes the United States invincible in war, but in so doing promises to become the greatest force for world peace ever discovered. Join Ronald Reagan, Operative 207, battling 20,000 unseen enemies to protect its amazing secret in Murder in the Air, 1940, the most exciting story of the Secret Service. This theme of portraying Tesla as a fictionalized madman actually predates the Ronald Reagan movie by a year, with the very first 1939 Superman comic made into a 10-minute cartoon 2 years later under the title Superman Captures Mad Scientist. In the premiere cartoon appearing at the height of World War II, the diabolical mad scientist not only threatens the modern city of Metropolis, high on a mountain top with his laser-like electrothansia ray, the crazed genius actually kills a bunch of motorists as he zaps out a bridge resembling the Golden Gate, and then, after capturing Lois Lane, starts to take down a major skyscraper before Superman comes to the rescue. January 1943. It was the height of World War II. Ignoring yet another treaty, the Germans had invaded Vichy France. In retaliation, D-Day was imminent. US troops were impinging, and Berlin and much of Germany were being bombed with impunity. On the Eastern Front, the Battle of Stalingrad was in full swing. Having already perfected their death-dealing V-2 rockets, Germany was getting closer to manufacturing jet planes. The actor Ronald Reagan was protecting America in the movies with his death ray, and way off in Illinois, at the University of Chicago, below the bleachers at Stagg Field, a team led by Enrico Fermi initiated the first nuclear chain reaction. President Roosevelt was now considering two separate kinds of superweapons, a nuclear bomb, suggested by Albert Einstein, and a death ray, suggested by Nikola Tesla. Had he listened just to Tesla, the president would have never considered the bomb, because Tesla had no belief whatever in Einstein's theories. It would be, by far, the inventor's greatest theoretical blunder. Concerning the properties of long-distance wireless messages, Tesla said, "This bending of the beam is not so much due to refraction and reflection off the ionosphere as to the properties of a gaseous medium and certain peculiar actions, which I shall explain some time in the future," emphasis added. However, the downward deflection always occurs irrespective of wavelength, all the more pronounced the bigger the planet. It might be inferred that I'm alluding to the curvature of space supposed to exist in the presence of large bodies, according to the teachings of relativity, but nothing could be further from my mind. I, for one, refuse to subscribe to such a view. Although Tesla was wrong about Einstein, having completely misunderstood the potential for the atom bomb, hidden in this revealing passage is the hint of one of Tesla's greatest secrets, his so-called dynamic theory of gravity. Replacing a curved space with a force field surrounding stars and planets, Tesla hypothesized that this view accounts for the propagation of electromagnetic surface waves that bend around large bodies. This is a far-reaching idea directly linked to what today is called the God particle, the particle that gives matter its mass. This idea will be explored in the last section of this treatise. Embedded in Tesla's FBI files was the highly classified Trump Report, which was an official dossier drafted shortly after Tesla's death in January of 1943 by MIT physics professor John G. Trump. Assigned by Vannevar Bush, head of the National Defense Research Committee, NDRC, and his emissaries, Irvin Stewart and Carl Compton, president of MIT, Trump was tasked to study Tesla's notes and determine if they contained information that should be prevented from getting into the hands of a foreign government. Trump, who it turns out was the uncle of a future US president, was a close associate of both Robert Van de Graaff, inventor of the famous Van de Graaff generator, who also worked at MIT, and Carl Compton's brother, Nobel Prize winner Arthur Compton, who cabled New York to express his condolences regarding Tesla's death. Where Trump's specialty included the ability to generate 1 million volts for X-ray machines for hospitals, Arthur Compton would use information derived from this research for top-secret participation in the Manhattan Project. An expert in the construction of high-voltage particle accelerators, Trump was a superb choice to study Tesla's papers. Spending just a long weekend, Trump concluded in his report that the last 15 years of Tesla's life were primarily of a speculative, philosophical, and somewhat promotional character, and thus his papers did not present any lines of research for the military to pursue. This was not at all the view of the people of Serbia, who expected the elderly wizard to return to his native land and protect them from the Nazi invasion, recalled Mike Markovic, an economics professor from New York University who had escaped war-torn Yugoslavia and emigrated to America. Attending one of my lectures, Markovic told me that the Nazis and their allies located in Croatia had murdered 90,000 Serbs. I saw the bodies floating down the river, he revealed. How did you survive? I asked. By sheer luck, he stated matter-of-factly. Western Union telegram from Nikola Tesla to his nephew Sava Kosanovich, ambassador from Yugoslavia. New York, New York, March 4, 1941. Although I am poor with words, I still didn't explain what would be necessary to increase up to 12 stations, 8 in Croatia, each of the same construction like at Wardenclyffe, and only 20 metres high, a ball 5 metres in diameter. The station would be using diesel oil for energy with mechanical action. My air turbines, steam-powered electrically or other manners of transforming into alternating electrical current with 60 billion volts pressure without danger. I'm waiting for Governor Subasic to select one station on top of Mount Lovchen. There will not be any light. Electrical energy will deliver particles through space with a speed of 118,837,370,000 centimetres per second, 3.9 times the speed of light. The particles can be larger than that of the diameter of a hydrogen atom, with metals of all kinds of materials sent to all distances with good results in war and bring about peace. In my attempts with an effective 20 million volts, electrons carried 40 times more electricity than normally and penetrated 2 meters in depth and terrible damage in a moment each. I have to finish so that I can later give you a fresh view. Warm greetings. I remain your uncle, Nikola. Throughout the 1930s, Tesla made no secret of the fact that he had invented a particle beam weapon, as he revealed numerous details of the device to a plethora of newspaper reporters. However, it wasn't until he alerted William Lawrence of the New York Times in 1940 that his prognostications gained the attention of the FBI, as well as various members of military intelligence and individuals associated with the White House. As World War II approached, and Roosevelt began to investigate seriously the possibility of creating an atomic bomb, a number of scientists associated with the Manhattan Project also became privy to details of Tesla's secret weapon. These individuals included James Conant, a chemist and president of Harvard University, Richard Tolman, a physicist, theoretical cosmologist, and associate of Albert Einstein, who speculated that the origins of the universe were oscillatory in nature, Frank Jewett, first president of Bell Labs, Leo Crowley, head of the OAP, who shortly after Tesla's death joined Roosevelt's cabinet, and Vannevar Bush, an early administrator of the Manhattan Project and head of the OSRD, who, like Crowley, had a direct line to the president. When Tesla's body was discovered, on January 7, 1943, management from the Hotel New Yorker alerted Tesla's nephew, Sava Kosanovich, ambassador from Yugoslavia, and he in turn notified Tesla acolyte Kenneth Sweezy, George Clark, who ran a research lab at RCA, and Hugo Gernsback, editor-in-chief of a variety of science fiction publications. As Gernsback ran off to get the materials to create a death mask, Kosanovich, Sweezy, and Clark entered Tesla's apartment, supposedly in association with two managers from the hotel, who in fact were from military intelligence, Colonel Ralph Doty and Army Private Blois Fitzgerald. Noticing that Tesla owned a sizable safe, Kosanovich contacted a locksmith, who successfully picked the lock and then changed the combination, giving Kosanovich the key. Looking for a will, which turned out not to exist, Kosanovich removed one or two photographs, and Sweezy took a book he had put together in 1931, containing letters from numerous dignitaries such as Nobel Prize winners Wilhelm Röntgen, William Bragg, Ernest Rutherford, Robert Millikan, Arthur Compton, and Albert Einstein, wishing Tesla a happy 75th birthday. They also noticed that Tesla's Edison medal was there, along with a set of keys, one of which was to a safety deposit box at the Hotel Governor Clinton, where Tesla had claimed a prototype of his particle beam weapon was housed. Other keys presumably were to other safety deposit boxes throughout the city, probably at the Hotel Pennsylvania, where Tesla owed the hotel $2,000 in back rent, and the Hotel New Yorker, which had a massive bank of safety deposit boxes on its main floor. Along with other papers, these keys and the Edison medal were returned to the safe. Although the FBI had been following Tesla for several years, it was determined that Tesla's estate fell under the auspices of the OAP. Kosanovich was a foreigner. That was the rationale. and so the FBI yielded jurisdiction. At the time of Tesla's death, the world was embroiled in the very height of World War II. As OAP Councillor Irving Giraud intimated, there was indeed a fifth column of German sympathisers centred in New York City, and that was probably one key reason why Wild Bill Donovan, head of the OSS, was interested in the Tesla death ray. In August of 1942, two German spies who were American citizens and six infiltrators from Germany were dropped off by a German U-boat and were later captured before they carried out plans to sabotage railroad lines, bridges, tunnels, hydroelectric plants and dams when several of them defected. In the loop and concerned about the possibility that the Germans could construct an atomic bomb before the Allies did, President Franklin Roosevelt explored the possibility that Tesla's particle beam weapon might be viable. On January 2, 1943, Roosevelt issued the following memorandum. The White House, Washington, January 2, 1943. For MAC, FDR's Appointment Secretary, Marvin H. McIntyre. To call Dr. Nicholas Murray Butler, President of Columbia U., and ask him to give you the lowdown on Dr. Nikola Tesla, whom the President thinks was formerly a professor at Columbia, and ask a bit about this letter. Signed, FDR. The letter no doubt refers to Tesla's so-called death ray, and it would seem that FDR was exploring the possibility of setting up a meeting, not realizing that Tesla was withering rapidly and would be dead just 7 days later. Then, 1 year after Tesla's death, with the outcome of the war still uncertain, Hitler tried again to directly attack America, sending out two more submarines to surface on the banks of Amagansett past the Hamptons at the far end of Long Island. Four Nazi saboteurs emerged. Although they were spotted, it was dark and they slipped their tail and somehow made their way, most likely by rail, 107 miles to the heart of New York City. Their targets were the great Tesla turbines that ran the subway system, hidden in a colossal sub-basement beneath Grand Central Station. Their weapon, sand. Had they succeeded in simply infiltrating the great generators with their sand, they would have literally brought the city to a halt. Commuters, supplies, and troops would have no longer been able to be transported. This act, had it succeeded, would have crippled the Big Apple and made it impossible to ship goods to the ports, and thus to the front lines. Fortunately, they were caught. Two of the men were executed, and FDR commuted the executions of the other two in exchange for them to reveal the details of their orders. The Trump report was explicit in expressing Trump's opinion that, although Tesla sold the details of his particle beam weapon to the Soviets, there really was nothing of military importance to the details of its construction. Although the investigation brought to light nothing of value of significance to the war effort, the OAP's Homer Jones wrote to Lawrence M. C. Smith, chief of the Special War Policies Unit, War Department, on February 4, 1943, it is believed the search was entirely worthwhile and justified as a precautionary measure in the national interest. In a few years hence, it will be possible for nations to fight without armies, ships, or guns, by weapons far more terrible to the destructive action and range of which there is virtually no limit. Any city at any distance whatsoever from the enemy can be destroyed by him, and no power on earth can stop him from doing so. If we want to avert an impending calamity and state of things which may transform this globe into an inferno, we should push the development of flying machines and wireless transmission of energy without an instant's delay and with all the power and resources of the nation. Nikola Tesla, circa 1925, as told to John O'Neill. Even though Trump was dismissive of Tesla's invention, exhibits D, F, and Q of his report refer to the highly technical and heretofore underground Tesla treatise written in 1937 titled The New Art of Projecting Concentrated Non-Dispersive Energy Through Natural Media. This article, in contradiction to Trump's statement, seemed to offer the promise of describing explicit information on the actual workings of a particle beam weapon for destroying tanks and planes, and for igniting explosives. So, where Trump had overtly written off Tesla's weapon as non-essential, other branches of military intelligence continued to search for a working model. In September of 1945, Colonel T.B. Holliday, Chief of Equipment Laboratory, Engineering Division at Wright Field, Dayton, Ohio, wrote to the Office of Strategic Services wondering if they might have information as to the weapon's whereabouts. And James R. Murphy, head of counterintelligence for the OSS, wrote back, "Dear Colonel Holliday, since receiving your letter of September 5th and following my conversation with Private Blois Fitzgerald, we have searched the records of the office and have talked with Major Coolidge and others concerning the data you mention. I shall be pleased to cooperate in every way possible to make available the copies or translations to which you refer." Murphy explicitly mentions later in the letter the Tesla papers. "But regret there appears to be nothing in our files. Yours very truly, James R. Murphy." So, throughout the 1940s, and from then on, the search continued. And thus, for most of the next decade, that is, in my case, from 1976 until 1984, part of my task was to track down this elusive and highly sought-after paper. Summer 1984, Tesla Conference, Colorado Springs. Toby Gratz, head of the International Tesla Society, and physicist Elizabeth Rauscher decided to put together the first of what would turn out to be seven biennial International Tesla Conferences, most of them run by Steve Elswick. All were held in Colorado Springs, near the site of Tesla's 1899 experimental wireless station. At this first conference, I was invited to speak, along with War Games analyst Colonel Tom Bearden, ozone therapist George Freibot, MD, Tesla researchers Dr. James Coram and his brother Ken Coram, Robert Golker, who had built two enormous Tesla coils, Tesla's grandnephew William Terbo, Serbian theoretician Rastko Majlik, researchers Oliver Nicholson, Charles Yost and Murray King, and the medical doctor and parapsychologist Andrea Puharic, who was scheduled to speak about the problem of using Tesla technology to alter brainwave patterns at great distances. My talk was centred on Tesla's relationship with J. Pierpont Morgan. I explained, with slides and a discussion, precisely what went wrong with their partnership, and at the same time showed that Tesla's handwriting fell apart when their deal finally fell through in 1906. This was the first time any researcher, as far as I knew, had speculated that Tesla suffered a nervous breakdown when he finally realised that he would not have the funds to complete his wireless plans at Wardenclyffe. My plane landed the night before in Denver, but my bus was late in arriving at Colorado Springs, so I came into Puharic's talk about 10 minutes after it started. Puharic had been to the U.S. Psychotronics meeting, and Bob Beck, head of the society, had passed along Tesla's particle beam weapon patent application. This was the long-sought, top-secret paper, and Puharic was presenting all of the details right before my eyes. It was history in the making. What most likely happened was that one of the military personnel, and a veteran from World War II who had met with Tesla during the last months of his life, Ralph Bergstresser, whom I would later interview, had sat on the paper for literally 40 years, and then finally turned it over to Beck, who gave it to Puharic. Soon after, War Games analyst Colonel Tom Bearden noticed tremendous similarities of Tesla's schematics to the designs of a Soviet particle beam weapon published 7 years earlier, in the May 2nd, 1977 issue of Aviation Week and Space Technology, before Tesla's long-sought paper had ever surfaced. In comparing the drawings, I agreed, and therefore speculated that back in 1943, when Trump issued his report, in which he downplayed Nikola Tesla and his inventions, this top-secret paper was not removed from the estate, and thus its details were smugly allowed to be sent behind the Iron Curtain, where they were analysed by the Soviets. Ironically, the details of this weapon were barred from American public view, yet it was studied, worked on, and developed in the Soviet Union. However, as it turned out, as discussed later herein, Tesla's link to the Soviet Union was a lot more complicated than I had first assumed. One of the key features of the death ray was the realisation that this was not a ray at all. What Tesla realised was that if the device remained a ray, the electromagnetic beam would spread out too much and lose its effectiveness. Tesla's genius was in conceiving the idea of shooting out a thin beam of particles, tiny pieces of tungsten that would be propelled out the barrel at a terrific force. I had learned from Nancy Zito, the granddaughter-in-law of Tesla's right-hand man Coleman Zito, that around 1918, Tesla and Zito's son Julius Zito were bouncing laser or laser-like beams off the moon and timing the impulse. I knew that Tesla had designed laser-like effects as far back as the 1890s, but Tesla soon realized that if he wanted to design a weapon that would have a range of several hundred miles, a beam of light or electromagnetic energy would be ineffectual. That is when he came up with the idea of shooting microscopic pellets. Since they would not disperse, they would maintain their destructive force. Andrea Puharic, for me, had come full circle. He had notified me of important Tesla archives at the Hammond Castle in Gloucester, Massachusetts. He had given me inside information about Tesla's biographer John O'Neill, including the speculation that Bernard Baruch had played a role in dissuading Morgan from completing his funding of the Wardenclyffe project. He had written an important treatise on Tesla's magnifying transmitter, and now he had brought to the world the long-sought top-secret Tesla weaponry paper. Tesla's life pattern is so rare, as life patterns go, even among extraordinary humans, that it needs to be clearly explicated at the outset. Tesla himself considered that he had only one life, which was his work. It is true that he had never developed any emotional relationship, outside his parents and siblings, to any human male or female. I say this with some confidence because I was privileged to know many of the people who knew Tesla as closely as anyone knew him. John Hayes Hammond, Jr., whose father was a friend and financial backer of Tesla's, told me many a story about this relationship with Tesla for some 30 years. Agnes Holden, who was the daughter of Robert Underwood Johnson, Tesla's closest friend, knew Tesla both as a family friend and as her escort to some of New York Society's parties. I spent many an evening with John J. Jack O'Neill, Tesla's official biographer, going over his intimate personal recollections of his prodigal genius. From these and other intimates of Tesla, I caught glimpses of his presence, his mind, his ideas, and his personality that are nowhere to be found in his dry and dusty archives. How this absence of close human relationship came about can be traced, and it has meaning in his work and ideas. Andrea Puharic. Disappearance from history. Unknown to me, my real introduction to Tesla began when I was a boy, in the late 1950s. My father, Stan Seifer, at the time was a TV repairman, and I would go out with him on some of his jobs. At that time he would go up onto the roofs of the various houses to install TV antennas and also wire their homes for TV reception. My father also built TVs from scratch, and there were a number of them at his workbench in various stages of completion, along with testing equipment, many varieties of radio tubes, and other electronic paraphernalia. With my father, I constructed an induction motor, using large nails and wires wrapped to create magnetic lines of force, and with his help for a Boy Scout assignment, I constructed a fully working crystal radio set made out of a jar with wires wrapped around it, a dial made from a beer can, a crystal detector, aerial and ground connectors, and earphones. In 1986, under the tutelage of my mentor, Dr. Stanley Krippner, I completed a 715-page doctoral dissertation, Nikola Tesla, Psychohistory of a Forgotten Inventor. And 10 years later, I published the book Wizard, The Life and Times of Nikola Tesla, Biography of a Genius. When Wizard came out in 1996, it was several years before the internet became ubiquitous and what we call smartphones really took off. At that time, Tesla was still a very obscure individual. Yet, surprisingly, as early as 1992, when cell phones were the size of 16-ounce beer cans, Tesla was listed by the New York Times as being in the top 10 of people of interest by scholars using the Encyclopedia Britannica's Instant Research Service. The other 9 individuals were, in order, John F. Kennedy, Martin Luther King, Albert Einstein, Adolf Hitler, Edgar Allan Poe, Abraham Lincoln, Jesus Christ, Pablo Picasso, and Al Capone. Tesla came in 10th. 20 years later, on April 11th, 2013, GeekWire announced that Nikola Tesla had won a contest, crowning him greatest geek ever, over such rivals as Bill Gates, Alan Turing, Steve Jobs, Elon Musk, Mark Zuckerberg, Jeff Bezos, Gordon Moore, Linus Torvalds, Albert Einstein, Isaac Newton, Tom Edison, Galileo, Ben Franklin, Archimedes, Guglielmo Marconi, Madame Curie, Gutenberg, Alexander Graham Bell, and Leonardo da Vinci. Clearly, Tesla's name was back on the rise. When I wrote Wizard, I set out to uncover Tesla's actual role in the development of the many inventions listed earlier. At that time, there was a lot of disinformation about Tesla's role in the development of his most important achievements, especially in regard to the invention of the induction motor, the AC polyphase system, our hydroelectric system, remote control capabilities, robotics, and wireless communication. Even now, there is a myth that Tesla was incapable of understanding James Clerk Maxwell's equations on electromagnetic theory, even though his journals, such as Colorado Springs Notes, 1899-1900, are filled with incredibly complex equations. However, since my biography contained a strict chronology and cited all its sources, I found that disinformation about Tesla generally seemed to dissipate, and I'd like to think that my book helped spawn the publication of a number of new books on Tesla that are a welcome addition to the literature on this topic. Excellent new works that stand out include the well-illustrated Tesla, The Wizard of Electricity by David J. Kent, Lightning Strikes, Timeless Lessons in Creativity from the Life and Work of Nikola Tesla, which contains singular insights by John F. Wozzeck, and a new definitive, highly original, beautifully illustrated coffee table-sized biography, Wireless, The Life, Work, and Doctrine of Nikola Tesla, by the director at the Tesla Museum, Branimir Jovanovich. Other works include the impressive picture book, The Truth About Tesla by Christopher Cooper, with an introduction by myself, the weighty compendium Tesla, Inventor of the Electrical Age by W. Bernard Carlson, which argues that Tesla used illusion to sell his wares, an attractive oversized picture book, Tesla, The Life and Times of an Electric Messiah by Nigel Cawthorne, and a well-written compact text, Tesla, Inventor of the Modern by Richard Munson. Although most of his creations were generated in the 19th century, in actuality Tesla was a modern thinker. For his entire adult life, the wizard cautioned the world to stop its dependence on fossil fuels and seek alternative sources of energy. In his article titled Our Future Motive Power, written in the 1930s, Tesla discusses the very topic that Tesla Motors CEO and SpaceX founder Elon Musk propounds as the most pressing problem of our time: how to obtain alternative sources of non-polluting renewable energy. In this comprehensive piece, Tesla suggests not only waterfalls, but also harnessing the tides, wind power, solar energy, and geothermal energy, all avenues that would, in Tesla's words, harness the wheelwork of nature. It was not by chance that Tesla sought to solve the electrical power distribution problem, filling his notebooks with advanced calculations. He was also always thinking of the best way to help humanity move forward, but be respectful of the planet at the same time. This present book is centred on Tesla's link to war, particularly his connection to Telefunken, the German wireless concern, during the run-up to World War I, and the related complicated legal battles in wireless when Marconi sued Telefunken and the US Navy and Tesla countersued. With regards to World War II, since both the FBI and CIA have recently declassified their Tesla archives, I was able to compare redacted with unredacted passages. Along with new information I have obtained from the Tesla Museum in Belgrade, from the research facilities of Prometheus Films in our production of the Tesla Files TV show, and from Tesla aficionados from around the globe, I have been able to greatly expand my understanding of what Tesla's role was during these wars, including which world leaders he interacted with, particularly during the onset of World War II. Further, I was also able to shed a great deal more light on the rather complex story of discovering precisely what happened to his top-secret papers after he died. Tesla is becoming more and more a household name, in part because of his take-your-breath-away photos that grace the internet, and because he appears frequently on TV shows such as American Experience, Ancient Aliens, The Tesla Files, and in particular, The Big Bang Theory, 2007 to 2019, with a worldwide audience of nearly 50 million. Tesla also appears in motion pictures such as The Current War, La La Land, Tesla starring Ethan Hawke, Final Frequency, and also The Prestige, whereby the wizard is played by rock star David Bowie. In print media, Tesla graces such popular books as James Redfield's The Tenth Insight, the sequel to his blockbuster breakout book The Celestine Prophecy, and Seventh Plague by James Rollins, and Tesla's name plays key roles as non-human characters. The advanced roadster in Razor Girl by the sardonic author Carl Hyacin, and the self-driving electrical vehicle in Origin by mega author Dan Brown. In 2010, Tesla was mentioned by President Barack Obama when he was listed along with Sergey Brin, Andrew Carnegie, and Albert Einstein on a talk on immigration. 5 years later, Steven Spielberg dropped Tesla's name along with those of Tom Edison, Alexander Graham Bell, and Steve Jobs when he compared these iconoclasts to George Lucas when his close friend became a Kennedy Center honoree. Another key aspect to this is the personality, accomplishments, and genius of Elon Musk, who has not only created an incredibly advanced electric vehicle named after the inventor that he launched literally into space in February of 2018, but he also contributed other accomplishments in perfecting solar cells and his incredible SpaceX rocket ships. Thus, Tesla's name is frequently mentioned when the most advanced technologies are discussed in unrelated stories. For example, in An Inconvenient Sequel, Truth to Power, the Al Gore sequel to An Inconvenient Truth, as the former vice president seeks to get India to agree to sign on to an international agreement addressing climate change, he calls Elon Musk, mentions the word Tesla, and gets Musk to agree to provide solar cells to India as an incentive to move them away from building air-polluting, coal-operated power plants. In the case of the recent Ebola and COVID-19 pandemics, ozone therapy has made the news as a possible treatment, and thus Tesla's name arises again because Tesla invented and patented an ozone generator in 1896, patent number 568,177. And this simple fact is therefore mentioned in scientific articles that discuss the possible efficacy of this treatment. In other words, the word Tesla has simply re-entered the lexicon as a matter of course. As solid evidence of Tesla's newfound worldwide appeal, when Matt Inman of the Oatmeal website worked with Jane Alcorn, head of the Wardenclyffe project, to set up a crowdfunding campaign in 2012 to purchase Tesla's laboratory out on Long Island, 33,000 people from 108 countries raised $1.4 million in 10 days to save Wardenclyffe. Tesla was a great writer and an amazing predictor of the future. One of his most brilliant quotes came in 1904, when he was trying desperately to talk his backer, J. Pierpont Morgan, into providing the rest of the funds he needed to complete his great wireless enterprise known as Wardenclyffe. "The results attained by me have made my scheme of world telegraphy easily realizable. It constitutes a radical and fruitful departure from what has been done heretofore. It involves the employment of a number of plants, each of which will be preferably located near some important centre of civilization, and the news it receives through any channel will be flashed to all points of the globe. A cheap and simple pocket-sized device may then be set up somewhere on sea or land, and it will record the world's news or such special messages as may be intended for it. Thus the entire Earth will be converted into a brain, as it were, capable of response in every one of its parts. Since a single plant of but 100 horsepower can operate hundreds of millions of instruments, the system will have a virtually infinite working capacity." Nikola Tesla, 1904. Several things about this quote are truly amazing, foremost being the idea of conceiving of the Earth itself as one totality able to feel in all its parts. Compare this prescient idea with the actual development and invention of what came to be called the World Wide Web. The scene is the late 1980s, in Geneva, Switzerland, as a group of scientists from all over the world were building on the work of DARPA, Defence Advanced Research Projects Agency, expert Vint Cerf on the development of the Internet. Their goal was to augment communication with each other in their attempts to complete the construction by CERN, the European Organisation for Nuclear Research, of a huge particle accelerator that came to be known as the Large Hadron Collider, and also to share information with other comparable centres of research around the globe. To make communication between the experiments and the particle physicists scattered all over the world easier and more effective, Sir Timothy Tim Berners-Lee, a British computer scientist working at CERN, developed a new networking system that eventually became the World Wide Web, WWW, in 1989. During the development period, its basic concepts, such as URL, HTTP, and HTML, were defined. They are still in use today. The first browser and server software was also created at this time. Berners-Lee made his ideas freely available, with no patent and no royalties due. CERN management decided to give this invention to the public domain and make it available to everyone for free. The Internet, a global network of information and easy accessibility that was previously used by only a handful of scientists, military personnel, and computer nerds, was made available to the general public in this act of generosity. Michael Krauss, 2014. Ironically, as we shall come to see, the Higgs boson, often called the God particle, the hypothesized particle that gives matter its mass, which was apparently discovered at CERN, is directly linked to Tesla's little-known dynamic theory of gravity. By exploring Tesla's theory in this light, a new view on cosmogenesis and the ultimate structure of matter may emerge. Tesla, Wizard at War, covers a lot of territory. The book seeks to fill in previous blanks, explore relationships Tesla had with individuals he has never been linked to before, create a more full-bodied description of who the man was and how his wireless tower at Wardenclyffe was supposed to operate, explain precisely his role in providing advanced technology and weapons development for both world wars, and also explain how his more advanced theories on the nature of gravity result in a rather elegant explanation of precisely what the God particle is. Our story begins with Tesla's own recollections about his childhood and later life. Part 1. High Life. When natural inclination develops into passionate desire, one advances towards his goal in 7-league boots. Nikola Tesla. My Inventions. 1919. Chapter 2. Interview with Nikola Tesla. I have seen men hung, beaten to death, shot, quartered, stuck on a pointed stick, heads chopped off, and children on a bayonet like quails on brush at Delmonico's. Nikola Tesla. In 1895, or thereabouts, Tesla brought several Serbian ballads to his friends Robert and Catherine Johnson. One of them, Luka Filipov, was written by Zmaj Jovanović, Serbia's renowned poet, whom Tesla met when he returned to Serbia in 1892. It is about a recent war, circa 1870s, between the Serbs and the Turks. One more hero to be part of the Serbians' glory. Lute to lute and heart to heart, tell the homely story. Let the Muslim hide for shame, trembling like the falcon's game, thinking on the falcon's name. Luka Filipov. During the ensuing conflict, Luka is wounded in battle, and a Turkish prisoner is caught. We have fired, but Luka's hand rose in protestation, while his pistol's mute command needed no translation, for the Turk retraced his track, knelt and took upon his back as a peddler lifts his pack. Luka Filipov. How we cheered him as he passed, through the line a swinging gun and pistol, bleeding fast, grim but loudly singing, lucky me to find a steed fit to give the prince for speed, rein or saddle ne'er shall need, Luka Filipov. And so Luka is brought to meet the prince. And as couriers came to say that our friends had won the day, who should up and faint away, Luka Filipov? One can easily envision Tesla in the Johnsons' living room translating on the fly this classic verse to Robert and Catherine's delight. An unforgettable moment of deep bonding, this would be a watershed evening that would reverberate throughout their lifelong friendship. And so Robert became Dear Luca, and Catherine became Dear Mrs. Filipov. When Tesla's translation appeared in Johnson's book of poems, Tesla included a discussion of the sad fate of the Serbian people. The turning point occurred in 1389 at the Battle of Kosovo, whereby 30,000 Turks destroyed the Serbian nation. Tesla writes that Europe can never repay the great debt it owes the Serbians for checking, by the sacrifice of its own liberty, that barbarian influx. The Battle of Kosovo, I would learn, is as important to the Serbs as the flight of the Hebrew slaves from Egypt is for Jews, and the crucifixion of Jesus is to the Christians. Thus, to understand Tesla, we must keep in mind that he's a Serb, and that as such, he carries this complex heritage. As Professor Mike Markovich explained to me regarding the Battle of Kosovo, it follows us always. Due to deep-rooted enmities among the Serbs, Croats and Muslims, even today they are unable to get along, with over 100,000 perishing when civil war erupted in the mid-1990s, thereby splitting Yugoslavia into seven separate nations. As a young man, when Tesla took to the hills, in part to avoid the draft, he encountered what Joseph Conrad called the Heart of Darkness, where villages were sacked and the men murdered and their heads put on stakes. But the women and children suffered similar fates. I was choken mad with thirst, and the man that spied me first was a good old grinning, grunting Gunga Din. Both Catherine and Tesla read Rudyard Kipling's The Jungle Book and Rikki Tikki Tavi, which Tesla liked best. On April 1, 1901, after his return from his experiments in Colorado, Tesla met the world-famous poet for lunch. "What is the matter with ink spiller Kipling?" Tesla exclaimed to Mrs. Filipov. "He dared to invite me to dine in an obscure hotel where I would be sure to get hair and cockroaches in the soup. He carried me away to where a dooley lay, and a bullet come and drilled the beggar clean. He put me safe inside, and just before he died, 'I hope you liked your drink,' says Gunga Din." Both Tesla and Kipling shared similar views of the horror of war and praise for great heroes. Tesla writes in Robert's book Poems that the Serbian hero, Marko Kraljevic, when vanquishing Musa, the Muslim chief, exclaims, "Woe unto me, for I have killed a better man than myself." Kipling, of course, uses the same observation in his iconic verse. About the time Tesla was conceived, according to Tesla's father, a divine phenomenon occurred. A large meteor, perhaps the size of a house, streaked across the sky, pouring sparks, leaving a trail of purple stripes behind, and when it disappeared beyond the first hill, there was a dawning, as though some great tower had collapsed, and the echo reverberated on the south side of the velabit for a long time. The following year, during a terrific lightning storm at midnight on July 10, 1856, Nikola Tesla was born. When the midwife tried to suggest that being born during a storm was a bad omen, according to legend, Tesla's father instead insisted, "No, this will be a child of light." Myths continued to abound, captured most eloquently by Tesla's first biographer, John O'Neill, who wrote, "Even the gods of old, in the wildest imaginings of their worshippers, never undertook such gigantic tasks of worldwide dimension as those of Tesla, himself an invention, a self-made superman, designed specifically to perform wonders, and he achieved them in a volume far beyond the capacity of the world to absorb." In 1919, at the age of 63, Tesla penned his autobiography. 2 years later, in April of 1921, American Magazine published another rendition. The piece was described as follows: "Great inventor tells the romantic story of his life." The piece, recaptured in part next, begins with Tesla stating that he was born in an old-fashioned home, 2 miles away from any neighbour. His mother is described as an indefatigable worker, arising every morning at 4 a.m., while others slumbered, making breakfast, assisting the servants in feeding the animals, and fashioning various tools through her own inventive spirit. Tesla then describes the fountain of my enjoyment, his magnificent Machak, the cat whom Tesla played with as a child, rolling around down a hill, indulging in this enchanting sport day by day. Pausing in the story, he relates an indelible occurrence that made a profound impact on his later life. It happened on the day we had a cold drier than ever observed before. People walking in the snow left a luminous trail behind them, and a snowball thrown against an obstacle gave a flare of light, like a loaf of sugar hit with a knife. At dusk, I felt compelled to stroke Machak's back, which became a sheet of light, and my hand produced a shower of sparks loud enough to be heard all over the place. My father was a very learned man, but this phenomenon was new even to him. Well, he finally remarked, "This is nothing but electricity, the same thing you see on the trees in a storm." My mother seemed alarmed. "Stop playing with the cat," she said. "He might start a fire." I was thinking abstractedly. Is nature a gigantic cat? If so, who strokes its back? It can only be God, I concluded. Here I was, only 3 years old and already philosophizing. I cannot exaggerate the effect of this marvelous sight on my childish imagination. Day after day, I asked myself, what is electricity, and found no answer. 80 years have gone by since, and I still ask the same question, unable to answer it. Tesla goes on to describe his two earliest inventions, a fish hook he used to capture frogs, and a motor created by fastening very large maybugs to a propeller. The maybugs never knew when to stop. The hotter it was, the harder they worked, until one day I saw the son of a retired officer of the Austrian army eating maybugs and seeming to enjoy them. I never played with the bugs after that, and to this day I shrink from touching any kind of insect. My childhood might have passed blissfully if I did not have a powerful enemy, relentless and irreconcilable. This was our gander, a monstrous, ugly brute with the neck of an ostrich, mouth of a crocodile, and a pair of cunning eyes radiating intelligence and understanding like that of the human. I aroused his ire by throwing pebbles at him, a most foolish and reckless act which I bitterly regretted afterwards. The moment I entered the poultry yard, he would attack me, and as I fled, grab me by the seat of my trousers and shake me viciously. When I finally managed to free myself and run away, he would flap his huge wings in glee and raise an unholy chatter in which all the geese joined. I had two aunts. One was Aunt Viva, who had two protruding teeth like the tusks of an elephant. She loved me passionately and buried them deep in my cheek, kissing me. I cried out from pain, but she thought it was from pleasure, and dug them in still deeper. Nevertheless, I preferred her to the other, whose name has slipped from my memory, and she used to glue her lips to mine and suck, until by frantic efforts I managed to free myself gasping for breath. These two aunts amused themselves by asking me all sorts of questions, which I remember a few. They asked me who was the prettiest of the two. After examining their faces intently, I answered thoughtfully, pointing to one of them, "This here is not as ugly as the other." They asked me, "Are you afraid of the bad wolf?" "No, no." This was the wolf I met in the woods near the church. After a number of such questions, one of the aunts asked me, "Are you afraid of the gander?" "Yes, yes," I replied emphatically, "I am afraid of the gander." I had good reason to be. One summer day my mother had given me a rather cold bath and put me out for a sun's warming in Adam's attire. When she stepped in the house, the gander espied me and charged. The brute knew where it would hurt most and seized me by the nape, almost pulling out the remnants of my umbilical cord. My mother, who came in time to prevent further injury, said to me, "You must know that you can never make peace with a gander or a cock whom you have taunted. They will fight you as long as they live." But now and then, on certain days, our geese, led by the gander, rose high in the air and flew down to the meadow and brook and sported like swans in the water and probably found some food. The sight of the flying geese was a joy and inspiration to see. As a very small boy, I was weak and vacillating and made many childish resolves, only to break them. But when I was 8 years old, I read The Son of Abba, a Serbian translation of a Hungarian writer, Josica, whose lessons are similar to those of Lew Wallace in Ben-Hur. This book awakened my willpower. I began to practice self-control, subdued many of my wishes, and resolved to keep every promise I ever made, whether to myself or to anyone else. The members of my family were not long in learning that if I promised a thing, I would do it. Long before I was 20, I was smoking excessively, 15 or 20 big black cigars every day. My health was threatened, and my family often tried to get me to promise to stop. And finally, after his sister almost died, he agreed. I have freed myself from this and other passions, and so have preserved my health and my zest for life. The satisfaction derived from demonstrating my own strength of will has always meant more to me in the end than the pleasurable habits I gave up. I believe that a man can and should stop any habit he recognizes to be foolish. When I was about 20, I contracted a mania for gambling. We played for very high stakes, and more than one of my companions gambled away the full value of his home. My luck was generally bad, but on one occasion I won everything in sight. Still, I was not satisfied. I lent my companions money so that we might continue, and before we left the table, I had lost all that I had won and was in debt. My parents were greatly worried by my gambling habits. My father often expressed his contempt at my wanton waste of time and money. However, I never would promise him to give up gambling, but instead defended myself with a bad philosophy that is very common. I told him that, of course, I could stop whenever I pleased, but that it was not worthwhile because the pleasure was more to me than the joys of paradise. My mother understood that a man cannot be saved from his own foolishness by someone else's efforts or protests, but only by the use of his own will. One afternoon, when I had lost all my money, but still was craving to play, she came to me with a roll of bills in her hand, a large sum of money for those times and conditions, and said, "Here, Nico, take these. They're all I have. But the sooner you lose everything we own, the better it will be. Then I know you will get over this." She kissed me. So blinded was I by my passion that I took the money, gambled the whole night, and lost everything as usual. It was morning when I emerged from the den, and I went on a long walk through sunlit woods, pondering my utter folly. The sight of nature had brought me to my senses, and my mother's act and faith came vividly to mind. Before I left the woods, I had conquered this passion. I went home to my mother and told her I would never gamble again, and there never has been the slightest danger of my breaking the promise. My father was the son of an officer who served in the army of the great Napoleon. He himself had received military training. However, both my father and mother were eager that I should become a preacher, but I had no leaning in that direction. From the age of 10, I had been inventing all sorts of things in my mind: flying machines, a submarine tube for carrying letters and packages under the Atlantic, and means of getting power from the rotation of the planets. All fanciful, but even after I had gone to study at the gymnasium at Karlstadt, Croatia, where I became intensely interested in physics and electricity, my parents still wanted me to become a preacher. Perhaps if I had not become very ill, I should have given up my promise. But because of overstudy, I had my first serious breakdown in health. Physicians absolutely gave me up. It was an American genius who saved my life. During my illness, one day I was handed a few volumes, unlike anything I had ever read, and I forgot my hopeless state. My recovery seemed miraculous. The books included early works of Mark Twain, among them Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn. 25 years later, when I met Mr. Clemens and we formed a lifelong friendship, I told him of this experience and of my belief that I owed my life to his books. I was deeply moved to see tears come to the eyes of this great man of laughter. Tesla's memory is faulty here, as Huckleberry Finn was first published in 1884. Tom Sawyer was a possibility, published in 1876 when Tesla was 20. And he may have also read the celebrated Jumping Frog of Calaveras County, which came out in 1865 when Tesla was 9. After graduating from the Higher Realschule at Karlstadt, on the very day of my arrival home, I was stricken with cholera, which was then epidemic in those parts. Again, I was near death. My father tried to cheer me with hopeful words. "Perhaps," I said, "I might get well if you would let me become an engineer instead of a clergyman." He promised solemnly that I should go to the best technical institution in the world. This literally put new life into me, and owing partly to my improved state of mind and partly to a wonderful medicine, I recovered. My father kept his word by sending me to the Polytechnic School in Graz, Styria, one of the oldest institutions of Europe. All during my first year there, I started work at 3 a.m. and continued until 11 p.m., neither Sundays nor holidays being accepted. Such leisure as I allowed myself I spent in the library. It was during my second year that something happened that has determined the whole course of my life. We had received a Gram dynamo from Paris. It had a horseshoe form of field magnet and a wire-wound armature with a commutator, a type of machine with a series of wire brushes constructed with a gap that changes the naturally occurring alternating current into direct current that has since become antiquated. While demonstrating this machine, the brushes of the commutator sparked badly, and I suggested that it might be possible to operate a motor without such appliances. Because alternating current changes its direction of flow at many times per second, the professor declared that I could never create such a motor, because the idea was equivalent to a perpetual motion scheme. The only way to go, he demanded, was through direct current. This statement from such a high authority caused me to waver in my belief. Then I took courage and began to think intently of the problem, trying to visualize the kind of machine I wanted to build, constructing all its parts in my imagination. I conceived many schemes, changing them daily, but I did not at that time succeed in evolving a workable plan. From time to time, in rare intervals, the great spirit of invention descends to earth to tell a secret which is to advance humanity. He selects the best fitted and whispers the secret in his ear. Like a flash of light, precious knowledge comes. The marvel that he sees, he knows it, and in his body he feels. It is a great idea. Nikola Tesla. 4 years later, in 1881, I was in Budapest, Hungary, studying the American telephone system, which was just being installed. Never for a day had I given up my attempt to visualize an electric motor without a commutator. In my anxiety to visualize one that would work, my health again broke down, just when I was feeling that the long-sought solution was near. But after 6 months of careful nursing, I recovered. Then, one afternoon, I was walking with a friend in the city park, reciting poetry. At that time, I knew entire books by heart. One was Goethe's Faust, and the setting sun reminded me of the passage. The glow retreats, done is the day of toil. It yonder hastes, new fields of life exploring. Ah, that no wing can lift me from the soil upon its track to follow, follow soaring. Even while I was speaking these glorious words, the vision of my induction motor, complete, perfect, operable, came into my mind like a flash. Pygmalion, seeing his statue come to life, could not have been more deeply moved. 1,000 secrets of nature which I might have stumbled upon, I would have given for that one which I had wrestled from her against all odds and at the peril of my existence. I drew with a stick on the sand the vision I had seen. They were the same diagrams I was to show 6 years later before the American Institute of Electrical Engineers. My friend understood the drawings perfectly, when suddenly I cried, "Look, watch me reverse my motor," and I did it, demonstrating with my stick. Alternating current transmission over longer distances was handicapped in the power field for lack of a motor. There was no satisfactory one until Nikola Tesla announced one in 1888. His polyphase system involved two or three currents from the same generator, each alternating in regular sequence, overcoming the dead points of a single crank engine, producing a rotation which the single-phase system does not. The unique feature of the new system was the induction motor, with no commutator, an essential part of the direct current motor, and with most ideal simplicity of construction and operation. Edward Dean Adams, President, Niagara Falls Power Company. Tesla solved the dilemma of how to harness alternating current and eliminate the commutator by creating two circuits, catty-corner and out of phase to each other, constructed with an armature that always pointed north. Thus, as the first circuit reverses itself, the armature is attracted to the north pole of the second circuit, and then, as it reverses, the armature continues onward attracted to the new north pole opposite to its original position of the first circuit, the net effect being that the armature continues to spin in one direction because north moves in a circle. This is the solution as to how to eliminate the commutator and harness AC unencumbered. This discovery is known as the rotating magnetic field. It is the principle on which my induction motor operates. In this invention, I produced a sort of magnetic cyclone which grips the rotatable part and whirls it, exactly what my professor had said could never be done. After inventing this motor, I gave myself up more intensely than ever to the enjoyment of picturing in my mind new kinds of machines. It was my great delight to imagine motors constantly running. In less than 2 months, I had created mentally nearly all the types of motors and modifications of the system which are now identified with my name. In the course of our investigations into the subject of power transmission, we came upon the inventions of Mr. Nikola Tesla, now so well known for his remarkable achievements. Recognizing the value and originality of his discoveries and the fundamental character of his patents, we at once secured the exclusive right to manufacture and sell apparatus covered by these patents. George Westinghouse, January 16, 1893. The inventions I have conceived in this way have always worked. In 30 years there has not been a single exception. My first electric motor, the vacuum tube wireless light, my turbine engine, and many other devices have all been developed in exactly this way. From Budapest I went to Paris, and there became associated with Mr. Charles Batchelor, an intimate friend and assistant of Mr. Edison. From Paris I made many trips throughout France and Germany, repairing the disorders of powerhouses. But I had no success in raising money for the development of my invention. When Mr. Batchelor urged me to go to America and undertake the design of dynamos and motors for the Edison Company. So I decided to try my fortunes in this land of golden promise. On arriving here, one of the great events in my life was my first meeting with Edison. This wonderful man, who had received no scientific training, yet had accomplished so much, filled me with amazement. I felt that the time I had spent studying languages, literature, and art was wasted. Though later, of course, I learned this was not so. It was only a few weeks after first meeting Mr. Edison that I knew I had won his confidence. The fastest steamship afloat at that time, the Oregon, had disabled both her lighting engines so that her sailing was delayed. The difficulty annoyed Mr. Edison considerably because it seemed that the ship...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.